Hey.
Hey, welcome to Heliotropes podcast. My name's Julia.
My name is Kojo.
And today we're going to be talking about the protests that have been going on in the United States over the past 7 to 10 days. So as coronavirus infection cases have surpassed 740,000 and deaths have surpassed 39,000 in the U.S., hundreds and in some states thousands of folks have taken to the streets to protest, including in states California, New Hampshire, Maryland, Virginia, Texas, Ohio, North Carolina, as well as some others. And the main focus of the protests have been to get back to work, to open the economy back up. People want to get back to work. And people are also protesting against what they believe is the government infringing upon their individual rights to make decisions in terms of going places and visiting people, etc.
And, you know, obviously one question you can ask is, who are these workers, right? Who are the people protesting? And largely, the people protesting fall into the conservative white working class category, median income of $75,000 a year, largely Trump supporters and or Republicans, based on, you know, what the reports, or based on the reports coming out from the media, based on what you can look at on articles or, you know, again, media coverage, mainstream media coverage. So with that being said, we're going to go into our approach to this particular story, what you need to know, what you're not going to hear from the media, and why we're covering it the way we're covering it.
Yeah, so in terms of our angle for why we decided this was important to talk about and why we're going to approach it in the way that we will, is because Kojo and I believe that protesting is a valuable political tool for voices to be heard and for causes to be shared. So when we protest, or when people who hold our values protest, we hope to be listened to and for others to make a genuine effort in understanding what has caused us so much distress that we've entered the streets with hundreds or thousands of folks to make a statement. So in an effort to stop fighting with the people and making it easier for billionaires and corporations to control the capitalist masses, Kojo and I want to understand the purpose of these protests and try to find connecting points with the protesters. So we're about a people's revolution, and in order to do that, we need the people. So we have to find points of empathy and compassion to connect with one another to create a larger coalition. And that includes people with people who are or who may seem to be on opposite ends of the political spectrum than we are, or have very different values than we have.
Right. And, you know, this is something that's particularly important, if not prescient, if you are a Bernie Sanders supporter, if you identify or identified as a Bernie Sanders supporter, if you you're an AOC supporter, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. One of the things she mentioned, if you'll remember, about 5 months ago when she announced her support for the Bernie Sanders campaign, is that she was she wasn't support, right? The media, one of the things they said did a lot was, oh, you know, how can you, as a, you know, Latina woman, how do you feel endorsing an old white man? And she didn't go and say that, you know, she supports him in spite of the fact that he's an old white man, but rather that she supports him because he's an old white man. And that is to say that she sees, right, the importance of linking her struggle as a Latina woman and the struggles of her community to the larger struggle across the board, regardless of race, right? Because as you know, if you're in the know, the big struggle, the largest struggle in this country is a class struggle. And there's a lot of distractions and a lot of obstructions in the way. So like Julia just said, that's heavily informing why we're covering this story the way we're covering it. And we hope that you get a lot of really good stuff out of it. All right.
So in terms of the legitimate economic grievances of these protests, we want to point those pieces out. So, as we mentioned at the beginning, folks want the country to open back up, right? So there's a real fear right now that a lot of us are experiencing, I think, in terms of being shelter in place for, I don't know, at least 3 weeks, 4 weeks, maybe more, depending on where you live.
Indefinitely. A lot of people don't know how long it's going to happen.
Right. Yeah, so we've been in the situation for several weeks and we don't know how much longer we're going to be in that situation. People have lost jobs, different income avenues, right, have been decreased. So people want the country to open back up so they can get back to work and make money to sustain their livelihoods across the board. Livelihoods can mean a lot of different things. Folks, at least folks in Michigan, are concerned about the uniformity of the shelter-in-place orders that have been distributed by the government there, because there are certain hotspots in certain states, certain areas of the state, and so they believe that things could be different for folks living in different places in the state. There's also a concern about government overreach and individual rights being infringed upon. So some lockdown orders, depending on where people live, are quite specific in terms of being able to go to certain stores or not be able to visit certain people, or not be able to like use boats or jet skis or other things of that nature. So there's a limiting of recreational activity as well.
Right. And, you know, with that all being said, it is important to note that essentially what they're protesting for is, and this is something that Julie and I have talked about a good bit, what they're protesting for differs from a lot of the protests that we've seen over the past few years, in the sense that they're protesting for something that's eventually going to happen. And their main concern is that it happens on their timetable, right? So it's important to, you know, with all of our, you know, predispositions of judgment, to suspend those at least a little bit as far as those goals, right? Like as far as protesting to open the economy back up. Because while there are major considerations as far as safety to be taken, as far as opening the economy back up, that is something that is going to need to happen eventually. And it makes sense that we do prepare for those things, at least in the short term. One of the things, are we ready for trade agreements?
Mm-hmm.
One of the fundamental economic concerns that's been, or rather economic elements that's been impacting this community, and, you know, to be fair, it's not just this community. It's not just white working class, conservative white working class Americans. It's really Americans across the board, working class Americans across the board. One of those super serious elements to consider is the item of trade agreements. All right, so we're going to talk about trade agreements a little bit. And in order to do that, I'm going to reinvoke Bernie Sanders, and some of the big trade agreements over the past 20, 30 years, including NAFTA and TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So, excuse me. In just a few years ago, in 2015, when the TPP was, you know, being debated and on congressional floors, Bernie Sanders gave a speech to the President of the United States, so Barack Obama, arguing against the TPP. And what he did in that argument was he brought up points that people had made in the past in support of previous trade agreements. He brought up points that current Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell had made in favor of NAFTA, points that the Conservative Heritage Foundation had made in favor of NAFTA, points Bill Clinton made in favor of NAFTA, things like that. And ultimately, like, these points, right, because the white working class historically has been relatively listened to, right? And I don't want to say that in the sense to, like, detract from, you know, the negligence that's been wrought upon them. But, you know, as far as, you know, major blocks and voting groups, people who have clout and have had clout for a while in this country, white working class, conservative white working class, southern white working class, is one of them. Go ahead.
Just going to point out that the very fact that there's language around that demonstrates your point, right? Yeah. That it's that there is a white working class that folks and politicians who are trying to garner support and get elected refer to a white working class and not a poor class or a working class that is inclusive of people from all racial and ethnic backgrounds.
Boom. That's a good point. One of the things that people who are in favor of these trade agreements tend to, really purport is, it's going to create jobs, right? It's going to create economic opportunity for Americans. And what tends to happen, this is a line, this is a quote from Bernie Sanders' speech, right? He said that since 2001, we have lost over 60,000 manufacturing facilities in America, right? And that is the quote, right? 60,000 facilities, not jobs, like places where people work, 60,000. He went on to say that since the creation of NAFTA, we have lost, and this is in 2015, over 680,000 American jobs, right? That's more than 500,000 jobs. And that's huge, right? It's just one of those things to keep in mind. All right, so what are trade deals? What are trade agreements? One of the things that they aim to do is to reduce tariffs and trades to barrier for whatever listed group of countries, to make it cheaper, right? Okay. And one of the things it does is it makes it cheaper for foreign goods to enter your markets. So, due to different currency values and, looser labor standards around the world from trading partners like China, in the case of NAFTA, trading partners like Canada and Mexico, it also makes it, right, easier for these goods to, certain countries are able to produce goods at lower costs than we are. And what happens is, obviously our markets get not flooded, not overwhelmed, but yeah, in a sense, the presence of foreign goods in our markets grows by a lot. And what that does is it reduces the profile, reduces the capacity to make money for domestic businesses, right? If I make socks and I sell them at $10 a piece, and then China can make socks at $1 a piece and then sell them here, people are gonna buy socks for $1 unless they really really like me, all right?
Or your socks.
Or my socks. Yeah, exactly, exactly. So I mean that's something that's really important to keep in mind as far as trade agreements. Some more stuff that's important to keep in mind is that these trade agreements tend to lead to the phenomenon of outsourcing. And for the most part, everyone's familiar with outsourcing. And right, as far as that particular byproduct, companies, domestic companies outsource labor, right, to companies, to countries where it's cheaper, right? And that increases their own profit margins at the expense of domestic jobs. Okay, so Ford can make so many cars at $100,000 for pieces, right? But anyway, not going to go with that. The point is, if you're a business owner, if you study economics, that, the economists and the stats, the data suggests that the most expensive part of operating a business is labor, because humans are valuable. And right, it should be. You're working, people aren't machines, right? They need to survive. You should value that labor. But what ends up happening is American companies say, hey, I don't want to pay so much for, to hire Americans if I can hire non-Americans abroad at a fraction of the price, right? And that usually comes with its whole host of human rights violations and everything. Not going to get into all that. But then it results in American companies deciding to outsource their companies, their manufacturing abroad, and that further exacerbates the loss of jobs, right? Like, these facilities don't just disappear. The 60,000 facilities under NAFTA, they didn't just disappear. They moved, right? And that's American companies deciding to move away. Another thing that happens is, right, pay raises, right? Because, you know, it's worth noting that the MO of corporations over the last few decades has been to transfer these savings, right? The savings that they make in outsourcing these jobs, not into raises for, like, the average people who are working, right? Not into minimum wage, raising the minimum wage, not into raising the average wage, not into living wages or providing benefits. Yeah. They don't do any of that. They don't look at, right? That's not the MO. Some people might do it, but that's not the norm. The norm, by and large, for, you know, a lot of really significant, right, Fortune 500, Forbes companies, is to transfer that savings into increased profits for their top level executives. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's raises, that's bonuses, it's, you know, benefits, any of these things, right? And that's all part of this whole neoliberalism ideal, right? Or you're at unfettered capitalism, free market capitalism, no regulation. Companies aren't being told that they can't do this stuff, right? They are not being told that they have to look out for the people on the bottom. Mm-hmm. They're being told and encouraged to make money at all costs. So, you know, that's just, you know, the capitalist connection here. And it's also worth noting that another consequence of free trade agreements that's manifested recently is that it damages the domestic supply chain, right? So one of the things that we're hearing about ventilators is they're really expensive to make. Why are they so expensive to make? Well, part of it is because all these different parts, we have to get them from a whole bunch of different countries, right? We have everyone manufacturing different parts of this machine that we need, not necessarily because that's just the way it is, but because the outsourcing for these parts, or these parts have been outsourced. The manufacturing of these parts have been outsourced. So now that, you know, our own productive capability is impaired, it's a thing that we can see, oh, you know, maybe we shouldn't have engaged in all these free trade agreements with all these different people. You know, like, we've got China over here. Anyway, not going to go into a whole bunch of stuff like that. But that's just a really basic rundown of the impact that free trade agreements have on the economy. And again, it's across the board regardless of race. But since the white working class makes up by the numbers, right, per capita, the largest portion of the working class in America, they are, by and large, the most widely affected demographic.
All right, so to connect back around the importance of discussing the trade agreements that have been in place over the past 30 years, really demonstrates the impact that corporations and politicians from both Democratic and Republican parties have had on working class and white working class individuals in terms of job loss, job security, and wages, and why that could be connected to the protesting now.
Right. And with that being said, you know, it's not all gravy, and we're about to dive into some of the more unsavory elements of the protests and why, right? As far as history, as far as identity, and as far as, like we mentioned before, those things which ultimately prevent a unified class consciousness from developing in America. We're going to start with white identity politics. All right.
Yeah, get it.
So, just real quick rundown of the history. We go back to the Civil War, Confederacy versus Union, states' rights versus, right, the federal interest, right, the interests of the country. The South lost the Civil War, and that was essentially the loss of the right to have slaves, all right? So that's an important thing to keep in mind, because that thread connects directly to today in very ironic and hypocritical ways. We fast forward to the Civil Rights Movement, and I guess that, yeah, 100 years later, 110 years or so, because we're actually in the post-Civil Rights Movement, 1970s to the 1980s, And there were a lot of, you know, disenfranchised white people, right? Disenfranchised white Democrats who felt that the advances that, you know, people of color, African Americans, Latinx people had made in the 70s, or women actually included hugely in that, the advances that they'd all made in the 60s had left them in the dust, all right? And this includes, yeah, I mean, they just, that was a feeling. And Republican politicians like Nixon, you know, other people, Goldwater, right? They felt this and they sought to appeal to that disenfranchised population to bring them in. And they did that with, anyway, under the umbrella of conservatism. Again, we fast forward to 1980s, Ronald Reagan, the Reagan Revolution, and he he doubled down on that appeal to the conservative right, to the new Republican coalition, which included a lot of these white working class people who wanted more. And, you know, ironically enough, again, in that instance, white working class interests, you know, allegedly butted heads with union interests, right? And things that are actually in the interest of the working class. This is not the most comprehensive rundown, but it's important. And then we get into today, right? We get into the economic crisis, 2008. We get into how Obama handled it under the neoliberal umbrella, and how, right, just that very, the neoliberal approach to handling an economic crisis is, you know, diametrically opposed to a working class interest approach. So there are a lot of people who, you know, voted for him, who do fit into this current category of protesters, who voted for him because of the hope and the change rhetoric and a sincere, you know, belief that he might be better than whatever the alternative was, which at the time was McCain. Those interests didn't pan out. You know, 8 years later, you got TPP, another trade deal that's costing Americans jobs and opportunity and is ultimately helping money flow up to the top. The 2016 election, where these voters rallied behind, you think about what Trump represented and what Hillary represented. For a lot of people, right, Hillary's deplorable comment suggested, right, exactly what Julia was talking about at the beginning, as far as doing the opposite of what we're doing, trying to do in this video, which is understand, right? The deplorable comment painted these people in a light that suggested that they're beyond saving, right? Beyond communicating, beyond
dismiss their legitimate concerns and their humanity.
Right, exactly. And then you look at the Republican side, and the one person that people saw who was speaking to them was Donald Trump. So, you know, for all, you know, the rhetoric against him, which a lot of it is very sincere and accurate, it's also important to note that he got the support he did because he reached out and he listened to these people. It's also important to note that in 2016, another person who was reaching out to these people was Bernie Sanders, right? Except he was doing it in a way that included, right, that complete class consciousness awareness. So he wasn't just appealing to white working class voters and their fears, which is intimately connected with race, xenophobia, all of these things that we have come to know them for. But, you know, Sanders was making that appeal across the board, you know, for African-American working class, Latinx working class, appeal to undocumented workers, right, immigration, because that's all connected into this, it's all economically integrated, right, and politically integrated. So there was that. That's the history real quick.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the piece that you mentioned about Trump reaching out to white working class voters, I mean, that's particularly important when you consider the power that lays, that, like, right, exists with white identity in this country in particular. So when you combine those two pieces, right, like, when you combine, if you're talking to the white working class and you're able to talk to folks about why their needs are so much more important than other people's needs because of their white identity, or at least it's that's like the underlying foundation of those comments, then you empower a whole group of people to stand in their whiteness and believe, right, that they are inherently more valuable and more important and should be taken more seriously and be more respected and more honored because of their whiteness, as opposed to actually addressing what their concerns are, which are jobs and wages and healthcare and being able to take care of their family and have a safe and secure life.
It's also worth noting that this, the white identity piece isn't just something that, you know, we notice when we go out in the street and we see a Confederate flag waving, right? It's something that's picked up on and perpetuated by the media as well, okay? Mm-hmm. Right, the whole deplorable comment, they didn't push back, no one pushed back and said, oh, these are just people, and I'm not going to say just, because the unsavory elements of, you know, that identity are important to address, but like Julia just said, so are the really legitimate, you know, mortal elements of it, right? The media didn't say, oh, you know, what about their genuine economic concerns? No, the media said, oh, like, look at them waving these flags and being very offensive. And, you know, that creates a feedback loop where they see themselves in the media and they're like, oh, yeah, that's us. And we do have problems, mm-hmm. right?
I mean, I think it's also important to note that the media gave a lot of attention as well. So kind of like to what you're saying, right? It wasn't that the media was saying like, these people are terrible or they're deplorable, right? But they were getting tons and tons and tons of free media and then being able to see themselves creating this kind of like culture and which I think some people at the time could describe kind of as this like cult-like culture, right? This where this identity is developing, and there was a real lack of concern, right? Like the schism just kept growing and growing and growing in a way that is, I think, like relevant to the time, right? Like the schism always exists, and then like as new leaders come up and new identities and new ideologies are discussed or, you know, just adapted and reformed, right? A different kind of schism can form or can manifest in a different kind of way with a sincere, in this instance, like just lack of care for people of color who are also in those same conditions in terms of like poverty and lack of jobs and lack of safety and lack of healthcare. But the whiteness carried it through and became more important, as it often does
in this country,
right?
Because in this country, and you know, and it's kind of tough to say, but it's also true, if you look at the country, it is more important. Right, that's the point of the word. That's the point of the entire dichotomy. And you know, that is a really good point as well. Is right, like you focus on the identity and you stop focusing on the issues, and then that schism that does exist. Right, you, after 2016, you know, there was all this talk of, oh, things are so polarized now, and they are very polarized because no one's actually paying attention to the people and the concerns behind the issues on both sides, right? People are only paying attention to the identities associated with those people on both sides, which creates this really complicated scenario.
Yeah. And they're paying attention to the identities they want to pay attention to.
Right. Insofar as confirmation bias, you know.
So that's a great lead-in to like this more critical examination of like hypocrisy and distractions and concerns as they're related to white identity in terms of the protests that have been going on this past week. So if you've been watching the news and seen clips of the protests or been reading about it, a majority of the people who have showed up to the protests have been white. Right, so that goes back to this question around white identity and if the concerns of the protesters are really around economic well-being for working class folks. One would think that would include all working class folks and people in poverty, right, to create, to enhance the well-being of everybody, to have a safer life in every meaning of that term. However, that's not what was going on in the protests, right? There's mostly white folks carrying American flags, some Confederate flags, some swastikas, a lot of Trump and Pence signs, right? So it calls into question then the legitimate concerns of the folks protesting when that's the atmosphere at these protests and rallies. Another piece is that, at least in terms of the Michigan protest, the like call for the protest or the description of it included some language around some distaste for dope shops and abortion clinics being open while churches are closed. And there was something else too, and I can't remember what it was at this point. But that leads to a question about if you're protesting for jobs and for the economy to be open, and those are both places that provide jobs and keep revenue coming in to the state, then, you know, like, why would you be protesting that those places are open, right? So there's this real question of, like, or a statement, I guess, in that sense of, we want the economy to be open and places of business to be open and everything else to be open on our terms and what we want to be open. And these other things we want to be closed, right? And there's this other piece around, like, garnering, right? Like, using, like, hot button topics or really impassioned topics like abortion to garner support. And that, like, can shift the message of the protest as well, kind of calling into question the, like, actual legitimate concerns around economic crisis. As you've probably seen, many, many, many people at the protest showed up with guns and not, like, holstered, concealed carry handguns, like, assault rifle guns, like, huge guns slinged over their chests. So it leads to this question of, you know, if you're protesting for economic safety and well-being, like, what are the guns for? And we know that guns are used as a form of intimidation and violence. And we also know that guns in the hands of people of color usually result in that person being killed. However, when masses of, what?
Not usually. But there is a stark difference in the way people perceive, you know, gun possession, firearm possession on a racial, along a racial line.
Okay. That's more accurate. I was getting, you know, impassioned and trying to make a point. And the point is that a group of white people showing up with a bunch of weapons on government grounds, right? They're showing up to state capitol buildings. They are not being arrested. I mean, in some, I guess in North Carolina, some folks are arrested. But for the large part, they were safe. They didn't, you know, have concerns about their guns being taken away or being shot because they were seen as a threat to the police or to the general well-being, despite the fact that they were going against shelter in place and lockdown orders from the state. So there's a real question about, like, if you're showing up to protest the suffering that you are enduring as a person who has lost their job and is in economic crisis and is really scared for their well-being, why do you need to bring your guns and potentially be making other people feel unsafe in that process? Right. And when that is combined with the chance of "lock her up" directed at Governor Whitmer,
Michigan,
yeah, that becomes particularly, like, threatening and concerning. And it positions, right, like, it makes the protest feel less about, like, their own safety and concern and suffering, and positions it in a direct clash that is meant to be violent.
Right.
And then there's also some kind of language pieces. So people kind of, like, in used in multiple ways, which has been, you know, kind of strange, like referring to Governor Whitmer, likening Governor Whitmer to Adolf Hitler because of how people feel that she is infringing on their rights to go places. And also likening being in a lockdown or a shelter in place scenario as slavery, and making comments about when there was a plague, at least like Pharaoh set the slaves free. So there's some like strong language being used. On the other side of that, there's the Confederate flags showing up and swastikas, which are like international symbols of violence and hate.
And real quick, just both intimately related to the previous comparisons, right? You have neo-Nazis marching in the same march with people who are comparing the people they're marching against to Hitler. And you have people with Confederate flags marching in a march for, you know, ostensibly their freedom to individual rights, in the same march with people, or rather those same people, would be comparing their situation to slavery in the sense that, you know, it's unfair to them. It's just, you know, hypocritical to the max.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and it brings up this point about relative suffering, right? Like when your identities in this country are so closely tied to the amount of suffering that you have been forced to endure, it provides you with varying levels of awareness and perspectives about what other people in this country have to endure and what they suffer through. And so this really demonstrates a lack of awareness around, I mean, basically everything Kojo just said, right? That it has been so distressing for certain groups of people to be in their homes. And many of these people, right, the people at the protests, especially in Michigan, had enough money to have a car and get gas and drive to Michigan. So the assumption there is that there's at least some sort of like financial
security.
Right, exactly. So one would assume that they have a safe home, they have running water, electricity, internet, TV, right? Like things that can keep them entertained in a month of having to stay at home with a potential other month like coming up.
And, you know, as we noted at the beginning, average, or rather the median income of, you know, white working class families, or the middle class, right, in this country is $75,000. Okay, that's a pretty significant buffer to poverty versus, right, when you compare the median and mean, like, instances of or wealth between white working class families and, you know, working class families of color, it's significantly higher, right? So as far as that, you know, piece on relative suffering, you know, it's just, it's an important thing to keep in mind, right? Like, if you're a working, if you're a white working class family, and you're like, oh, things are doing so bad for me, right? What is the statistic? The average, you know, white family in this country has 10 times more wealth than the average black family in this country. Is something to keep in mind, right? Like, if you're suffering, if you feel like you're sincerely suffering, like Julia is saying, and you want things to change around that because you're a human being, right? Because it's human dignity, like, you deserve it. Then you should also be fighting for those same things for people whose best, at best, they're doing as well as you are, and then having to deal with racism and sexism and all of these things, okay? And at worst, or really at average, they're doing 10 times worse than you are when you're doing your average. Just something to keep in mind.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's not a matter of, like, that people above a certain income aren't suffering, because everyone's trying to adapt to this new normal, but it's the piece around like how you are responding to it and how you're using your certain identities or certain like relative societal power to create change just for yourself without considering how other people are experiencing the world and this economic situation and health pandemic that we're in.
Right.
So pointing out some of these hypocrisies and distractions is particularly important because we need to hold on to the legitimate concerns and then also how those are manifesting in terms of the protest. And so Kojo and I had a long conversation about this a couple days ago. in terms of, like, we can't, if we're organizing a protest, we can't always decide, right, like, who's going to show up. However, we know that the language that we use to advertise what the protest is about and describe what it is, we know that that will bring certain people, right? So, like, if you're going to be talking about, like, abortion and drug use and some of these other things, that's going to bring out a certain kind of crowd of folks than if you are purely talking about the economic impact that coronavirus has had on working class folks. So holding, and that becomes problematic when the co-organizer of the Michigan protest did not denounce that the Confederate flag was at the protest. Instead, she said that she was offended that Governor Whitmer made a comment that the Confederate flag was at the protest. She said that was harsh language to use. So that's when things start to become, like, problematic and start to take away from the legitimate concerns that are at the protest. So we're trying to, you know, hold on to the things that feel really important that people are protesting, and then understand, you know, kind of like the hypocrisies and distractions that come out from it, and figure out how to make sense of them.
Right. So a few more hypocrisies and distractions that we're going to cover. And, you know, before we get into that, I want to go over really quick what neoliberalism is, because that's going to be a major part of understanding not only what we've already talked about in this podcast and previous podcasts, but going forward, how we understand the major hypocrisies, right? Because it's more than the hypocrisies in the actions and, like, you know, as far as they relate to what they're saying, but it's hypocrisies that are rooted in their actions as they compare to larger ideologies, right? So just real quick rundown. Neoliberalism is essentially a socioeconomic ideology that employs the state in the private sector's ability to acquire and maintain wealth. Okay, so private companies look to the government, the role of the government in this situation is to help private companies get money and hold on to money, all right? The private sector operates under free market principles with minimal regulation until they get in trouble, right? The bailout. Then they summon the nanny state, right?
Which because bailout?
All of them. All of them over the past 30 years. And, you know, they get into trouble. They summon the nanny state to come in and say, you know, hey, save us, right? Like, you get in trouble on the playground, and instead of taking care of it yourself, you know, this isn't advice for, like, being on the playground, right? But, you know, so to speak, instead of taking care of it yourself, right, you go around and you cause trouble. And then instead of holding yourself responsible and accountable for that, you go and get your mom or the teacher, right, the nanny. You go and get the nanny to come take care of you. And then you handle all of your problems like that, and there's no growth. That's what neoliberalism is, okay? And Diallo Kenyatta, he says, he's referred to it as socialism for the rich, which brings us to this next hypocrisy, which is seeing big government as a bad guy, right? And not only is this a distraction from the actual corporatist ideology bad guy, but it also contradicts their positions on things such as abortion and religious freedoms, all right? If you think that small government should be a thing, then you also shouldn't look to the government to go in and make abortion illegal, if it's already legal, okay? If you think small government is the thing, you shouldn't look to the government to go and step in and say, hey, you know, we need to be able to pray in schools and stop everyone else from praying in school, or, you know, whatever these religious freedom arguments are. And then, you know, another role of big government is, you know, this antipathy, right? Like, one of the things neoliberalism has helped instill, and this goes back to Reagan, right, and before, but it's this idea that if you're a working class person, the government is bad, right? And this came out of that whole post-civil rights era thing where, you know, now you've got all these, you've got the government stepping in to help give people of color more rights. And part of the way, you know, that was turned on its head to appeal to white voters is to say, hey, you know, like, the government, like, I don't need the government to give me rights, you know, like, you know, as a white person who's already well off, I don't need that. Yeah, right? Like, so like the government's over there handing handouts, right? Welfare, Social Security, Medicaid, Medicare, handouts to people who are just, you know, siphoning off of it. You get this image of the welfare queen who doesn't do any work and just like sits back and collects welfare checks like that. And that all connects to this and smaller antipathy for government and welfare, larger antipathy for socialism and democratic socialism, right? Socialized, nationalized services like universal basic income, healthcare, right? These things, right? So that's important to notice as far as this hypocrisy that comes, because, you know, Julia played a video the other day and one of the women was like, oh, you know, we're getting our unemployment benefits, we're getting our checks and we're taking them against our will. And it's like, oh my gosh, you know, well, no one's forcing you to take that money, one. And two, it's just a very, this voter bloc, right? You have to understand this bloc, this demographic, American demographic, in order to understand why anyone would see that as a bad thing. And then you have to understand these ideologies to really understand why anyone would see that as a bad thing. Because, you know, it's not like she sees it as a bad thing as in, oh, it's hurting her family. She sees it as a bad thing because she's been taught that given her identity, those things are bad. She doesn't need those things, right? Because she is white, because she is working class, she can produce, she should be able to produce everything she needs herself. And while there is some truth to that, it's not because she's white and it's not because she's working class, right? It's because people should be at the baseline given the things they need to be able to produce and take care of themselves. And, you know, in some countries that includes basic health care, nationalized health care, Social Security, things like that.
I think even further with the point about like believing based on her identities that she shouldn't need those things is that it would be, if she does need those things, right, then that would equate her with maybe a Black American in the States or like an immigrant in the States or something like that, which would be, you know, since white people have spent, you know, their entire existence in this country dehumanizing people of color.
Right.
It would create a huge identity crisis.
Right. And it's really, yeah, it's a good point. They're like, ah, yeah, can't be lowered to that level.
Yeah.
And, you know, the point isn't to lower, anyway, that's just, it's a very white ideology, very white, you know, worldview.
Yeah, and the piece about, like, what you were talking about in terms of the big government being seen as the bad guy feels also incredibly relevant to these protesters, right? Their idea about, well, like, what they're protesting is they're protesting against, like, they want the economy to open back up because they want their jobs, and they believe that right now, like, the government with their lockdowns and social distancing orders are the reason that they don't have the jobs, when in reality, right, like the corporations and the people at the top of the corporations are the ones who have fired them and laid them off and haven't provided them with living wages or healthcare and all of these things. And so they're fighting against the government when in reality that's not who has taken their jobs away.
Right.
And,
well, state governments. Because, you know, another major hypocrisy, you know, along the lines of what Julia was just saying, is they're out there in the streets protesting, right, their right to work. And it's instead, essentially, of protesting these fundamental forces that if you understand, you would understand how that contributed not only to the reason that they don't have work right now, but to the reasons that they don't have sufficient resources to feel comfortable in this current time, right? Because it's not just that they can't work, right? That'd be one thing if they couldn't work. Like you said, you know, we were talking about this earlier, and, you know, Julia mentioned that, right, these things aren't happening so much in Europe, right, because people are taken care of. They're not necessarily concerned about their health care. They're not concerned about not having an income because the government has already provided and said that they would provide these things, right? It's already understood that they will be taken care of for the good of the country, right? For the good of the people in that country. But here, we don't have those guarantees, right? We've got a one-time check of $1,200. We've got unemployment benefits that are going to run out. And in the meantime, like, while giving people these minimal things, we don't even have, like, nationalized rent freeze, across the board type deals going. So people are being asked to stay inside. They're being asked to abide by these, you know, shelter in place rules, and also being asked to just hang in there, right? Right. And I guess what I'm getting at is there's this sense of anxiety that builds up if you're thinking far enough into the future, right? Like, if you've got several kids to take care of, if you've got, any large expenses, right? If you've got coronavirus and you've got to pay for medical treatment, right? So you're not working, which means you're not making money, which means you don't have money, or your money is running out, right? Even if you've got the stockpile of money, that's going to go quick, depending on how you know, what your spending habits, you know, that's a whole other thing. But yeah, that's a good point. And another fundamental hypocrisy. Instead of being out there in the streets protesting neoliberalism, instead of protesting these trade deals, instead of protesting, you know, any number of things, they're protesting what the state government is doing to keep them safe.
Well, being part of organizations that are funded and deeply aligned with people who are incredibly wealthy or have positions of power. Like in Michigan, one of the organizing groups, so there were two organizing groups who, put together the protest, and one of them is co-founded by a GOP, government person, and the other one has ties to the Koch brothers and has ties to Betsy DeVos, and she and her husband also fund that group.
There you go. So let that be a note. And this is just a real, side note, but a lot of these things also apply on the left, right? So it's not the right that has it's not only the right that has some sort of exclusive sense of gross hypocrisies about it. They do seem to be a little grosser, but you're right. The left has its own hypocritical stances, including, right, this ostensible appeal to human rights that also somehow doesn't make room often enough for, the people on the right, which is just a really important thing to consider as we move forward.
So another hypocrisy that is important to discuss is the protesters endangering themselves and their community, with the idea that they're protesting for the well-being of their community. So in many of the pictures, folks didn't have face masks or gloves on. They're bucking social distancing protocols and requests from the government. So they're putting themselves and others at risk while protesting for individual rights and community well-being. So there's an interesting kind of like hypocrisy there in terms of what they feel free to do that could also be infringing on other people's safety. And then there's also this other like really practical piece, which is if people continue to gather in this kind of capacity and they get sick, because they're out of work and because in the United States, healthcare is tied to employment, right? Like then they're going to be relying on the government for their healthcare and to take care of them throughout the process of them being sick.
And this is, one of the questions that we came up with was, how exactly is it okay? How do you protest? What is okay to protest? Because if you'll remember, especially if you were paying attention to the Me Too movement, you were paying attention to the Black Lives Matter movement, you were paying attention to how CAP was leading that movement, the latter movement, as far as taking the knee, this group of current protesters was largely associated with criticizing the mode of protest, right? It's disrespectful to the flag, it's, whatever. There was all of these talking points about how they shouldn't be doing it and they're protesting wrong, when in fact no one was being hurt, no one was in jeopardy of losing, their physical integrity wasn't in jeopardy. It was real low-key. It was a loud statement, not because it was dangerous to people, but because it was dangerous essentially to a certain mindset. You compare that, right? You compare the it was a really benign mode of protest that received a lot of vitriol from the right. And you compare that to today, right? Like, the way they're protesting and the implications of that as far as people's health and as far as extending these stay-at-home orders. And it just creates this huge, right, like Julia said, right, it's super hypocritical and it's super worth asking the question, right? Because, you know, when, you know, I first came across this, I was very much like, okay, so what is a good way to protest? And does that mean that if there are stay-at-home orders that you shouldn't protest? I don't necessarily think that's true, but you, as, you know, protest organizers, you know, just like you have to keep in mind how you craft the message, you have to keep in mind or take leadership as far as what people need to protest and what people need to be doing to protest, right? Mm-hmm. If you're going to have this protest, make sure people are safe. Make sure they have masks. Make sure, you know, they at least make their own masks, right? Make sure they're social distancing. Make sure they're not blocking medical emergency routes, things like that, basic things.
Yeah. And if you do all those things, right, like if you're responsible in that capacity and people show up and they're not following those things, mm-hmm. then you denounce them because right. that's how that works. And that's how you maintain credibility and keep your message, the message that you're saying is your message, at the forefront.
Right, right. Super yeah. important. to close out, getting towards the end of the hypocrisies, they're Trump supporters. That's a major one. And it's subtle, but right. Supporting Trump, who literally represents in clear as detail this idea of regulatory capture, which is a neoliberal, it's not even neoliberal. It's a capitalist ideal, right? You accrue this capital, you have a bunch of money. Politicians are influenced by money. So the politicians and elected officials that you have in place to oversee regulations to make sure that the capitalist private sector is doing what they're supposed to be doing without doing too much damage. You use some of that money to get your own people into those positions so they form and shape regulation that's going to be in favor of you making more money. And that's Trump, right? Essentially. He is the private sector in the position of the government, the head of state. Literally, okay? So, you know, for all of these Trump supporters to not see that and not see how that plays out against them, right? Because again, right, while he's listening to their concerns and he's parroting like he's in on their side, the actions he's taking do not align with that, right? He is not, they just don't align with the core concerns, economic concerns, of what they're about, right? He represents the social solution to their concerns in the same way that like Nancy Pelosi or Joe Biden represents, or Obama represents social solutions to the left's concerns, right? They're superficial and not fundamentally interested in making things better for the working class because they're working for the donor class, except Trump is the donor class himself.
I think that's difficult too for people to kind of pull apart and understand depending on like the media that they're consuming, right? Because a lot of like if you trust Trump and you listen to Trump, right? Like he's using that language around like, yeah, we need to get jobs, we need to open up the economy, like it needs to be open by Easter Sunday, which was last weekend. And like if people, you know, die in that process, then they die in that process. And the difficulty in that is that it's always, right, like he's always shifting what the plan is or what the, like his ideology is. But it's difficult if you, like if you're somebody who trusts him and consumes the kind of media that also trusts and back him, because he's also using language, right? Like he's tweeted now about liberate Virginia, liberate different states, right? So he's like kind of co-opting this language around, I mean, it goes back to like the relative suffering piece and what it means to be liberated and free, right? And likening the situations to people who are under shelter in place orders for the well-being of the community so that coronavirus doesn't spread and spread and spread and kill. he's likening that to what it means to have lost freedom, which he knows and senses his base of support.
Right. And that gets into an interesting, anyway, yeah, no, I definitely, yeah, an interesting idea about how we use language and the language we use. You know, Ronald Reagan, his presidency, he's known as a president for having used the word freedom in speeches more times than any president before him, which is interesting because he used that freedom to sanction, you know, military interventions, to destroy trade unions, to right, to like take and, you know, erase as much as possible, as much as feasible, the advances of the civil rights movement, right, to bolster the prison industrial complex,
to let a ton of people die by HIV AIDS,
right, all in the name of, literally in the name of freedom. So super important point, very important thing to pay attention to, right? Liberate, freedom, these words don't mean, they mean what you think they do, but they're also political tools, right? And they're social tools to manipulate.
Yeah, dog whistling.
Yeah, dog whistling, that's what it is.
Yeah.
Final point on our list of hypocrisies to pay attention to, and this is something that we've addressed before, is this idea of holding their whiteness at the forefront of their identities at the expense of their class interests. Like we've said before, the class interest sounds, for a lot of reasons, to be like to be the thing that's at the core of their concerns, right? I don't have enough, I'm afraid I'm not going to have enough money, or I don't have enough money to pay for medical expenses, to pay for daily expenses, to pay for any of these things, right? Money is at the root of these issues, as it has been for a long time for a lot of poor whites, middle-class working whites in this country. But issues, right, like racial issues, right, being taught, right, there's this saying, I forget what it is, but it was, you know, exactly, but something along the lines of, you know, like, even the poorest white man in, like, the antebellum South could take comfort in knowing that at least they weren't black, you know? And it that points to the ways in which race has been used, manipulated, wielded, and crafted to create this division that prevents class unification and class consciousness, right? Instead of looking at things like, oh, you know, me and that person over there have literally different skin pigments, but we are both, you know, oppressed by, you know, people with more power than us who aren't looking out for our best interests at all.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of looking at things like that and saying, oh, you know, let's unify. It's, I mean, there's just no unification, because instead of looking at your neighbor and saying, oh, we have so much in common fundamentally, you look at your neighbor and say, we're so fundamentally different, based solely on the color of our skin, which is outrageous, right? It doesn't make any sense. But that's, you know, one of the things. And
the continued division, like racial, right, like white people maintaining this racial divide and schism, keeps us in the same kind of society that we're living in, right? Like, that's one of the ways that, like, the capitalist society is perpetuated. If you can always make people believe that they're white before they're anything else, right? Like, the system stays the way that it is because there's no unity among class or among sex or among, like, ability or among faith,
right?
Like, it's always, always, always based on race.
It's that divide and conquer mentality.
Right.
And, you know, worth noting that the upper class, right, the elite classes of American society have always seen themselves as a vulnerable minority, right, since the days of the founding fathers, right? Thomas Jefferson, Alexander Hamilton, John Jay, like, they've always recognized to some extent and feared that as that vulnerable minority, the masses, right, if they were given democracy, if they were given the ability to unite, would rise up against them and take their land and, you know, distribute it and make it in some sort of communist socialist paradise.
Yeah. If so, everybody could vote.
Right. If, yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And if everyone had a say in who they wanted to represent them, a genuine say. Hence, you get these political tools like gerrymandering and voter suppression that are inhibited. I mean, it's just things to pay attention to.
All right, the last thing that we want to point out about the protest in terms of like a hypocrisy piece is the toxic masculinity that seems to be inherent in this group of individuals who protest, which was on full display. And I found particularly disturbing in the Michigan protest because white men were showing up, like we mentioned before, with huge weapons, guns strapped across their chests and chanting, "Lock her up." And it is impossible for me in my mind to separate like the inherent violence that plays out in that scenario, like to hate somebody to the point of showing up with a gun and wanting to lock her up because you feel like she has infringed upon your individual rights. It's impossible for me to separate that from like domestic violence and general reactions to women and how these individuals like think about and like treat women, especially I think considering that people in these groups tend to be anti-abortion, and also tend to hold like these specific ideals of how women should behave and act. So there's this real like, you know, this like really firmly held belief that like I, as a man showing up to this protest, feel like women should behave in these ways and I should be able to limit what a woman can do with her body or a decision that she could make. But when the governor, who happens to be a woman, is putting into place regulations that are meant to keep the entire community safe, that has now become like a personal
attack.
That's become now a personal attack that I need to fight back against to the point of bringing my weapon and wanting her to go to jail.
And it's worth noting, right, the comparisons over time, right? Comparing this particular instance to the use of those same chants of "lock her up" against Hillary Clinton, and the kind of atmosphere in which those chants pervaded, right? It pervaded in an atmosphere where the person advocating "lock her up" at the top, who was Donald Trump, was also well known and well accepted by his supporters to have been a sexual abuser, right? I mean, that's just another piece that's important to keep in mind.
Yeah, it's important to acknowledge, as you're mentioning, right, like where that messaging has, where it started, and where it's come from. And showing up in that capacity to a protest with a gun strapped around you chanting "lock her up" to a woman because you disagree with something that she is saying alienates people and can bury your message because it is scary given what has now become the new norm, which many female-identified folks and other individuals who hold marginalized identities feared when Trump was elected as president of this country, that certain language and violence would become much more overt and acceptable. And we see that play out quite regularly now. It has become the new norm. All right, so that wraps up the content that we want to share about the protests and some of the ideas and thoughts that we've had while thinking about the protests over the last week. And this question that Kojo and I have been wrestling with for quite a while now, we also think would be great to leave you with. And that is a question around how you interact with individuals who have maybe different political beliefs or different values than you have, and does the way that you interact with them align with your worldview? So for us, believing in a safe and secure and just world for everybody includes bringing people into those ideas and hearing them out who may have been at these protests this past week so that we can understand their legitimate concerns, because their need for financial security and stability and to be heard are things that we believe should be afforded to everybody.
Right. So, hope you enjoyed the podcast. Episode 4.
Yeah, and if you are going to take on this question and you're not really sure where to start, there's a great film called The First Rainbow Coalition, and it is about the Black Panther Party in Chicago uniting with the Young Lords Organization and the Young Patriots. And it's a coming together of different racial and ethnic organizations to create some significant change.
Right. And also, if you have any questions, put them in the comments below. Don't forget to like, subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell so you know when we drop a new podcast.
Yeah. Shout out to Liz in California, hey, holding it down and provider of the best swag.
And also shout out to Maran and provider of the best, memories, Capoeira memories from back in the day. With the rest of the squad, shout out to Fernanda as well, and CB, and Pele, and anyone else who's listening to this podcast. And more cats in the future. Yeah. Hold it down, y'all. Keep it up.
Yeah. All right. See y'all. Thanks for watching.
Bye.